Okay, all right, great. Thank you very much. Okay, so I'm Russ Benedict, and I teach at Central College. And I have been there for about 10 years now, and I'm a biology professor. I teach one of the introductory biology courses, as well as a bunch of upper level classes on animal biology, a variety of different kinds. My favorite classes that I teach is called Tropical Ecology. And we meet during the fall semester, and then over winter break, we take a 16-day trip down to Costa Rica and Belize. And so you'll see a couple of pictures of bats in here that probably look unlike anything that you've seen before, and I'll explain that to when we get to them. But some of these tropical bats are a lot of fun. But no, there's actually a pretty decent connection between bats and gardening, and bats and just kind of overall enjoyment of the outdoors. They play some really important roles outside, and we'll get to that. And then you also get this idea that one of the greatest fertilizers out there is bat guano. And you know, there are places in the U.S. where you can buy bat guano, and it's actually pretty darned expensive. So there's some definite connections. Plus, I think you'll find that it's a pretty amazing group. And right here in Iowa, we've got some wonderful critters. So I think, if nothing else, just from the standpoint of getting to know the things that live in your backyard, I think is a great thing for anyone to know about. So what I'll do is I'll show you some pretty pictures here, and then if you have questions as we go along, certainly feel free to ask, and then I'll also have plenty of time at the end for questions as well, okay? All right, so let's get rolling. So what I have first for you is, since I am a professor, I'm a firm believer in quizzing people. So first we have a little bit of a quiz here for you. Okay, and this is a beautiful little Corolla, a little sheath-tailed bat from down in Costa Rica. And when you get down to the tropics, you get a lot of bats that have these little nose leaves, these little flaps of skin that stick up off of the nose, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. But bats are the only mammals that are capable of true flight. There's other mammals that can glide, including local flying squirrels. We've got one species of flying squirrel that's here local. But gliders cannot increase in elevation, they can only descend. These guys, because they're capable of flapping, are capable of true flapping flight. So name for me the other three organisms on Earth, current or extinct, that also are capable of flapping flight. I'm gonna take the easy one, birds. All right, I got the easy one. I always take the easy one. So who else?
Insects,
okay. The only one left.
Flying dinosaurs.
Yeah, the pterosaurs. There you go. So that's the four groups of organisms that have mastered the ability to truly fly and flap. And as soon as you flap, it just opens up a whole new world as opposed to just gliding. Okay, now next question. How many different kinds of bats are there worldwide? I want exact numbers, no guesses. Because that 100 sounded like a guess to me. 400. We've got a 400 guess here. Okay. Anyone else want to give it a shot?
560.
Ooh, she's getting precise. How about almost exactly 1,000? And in fact, about 23% of all mammals are bats. By the time you add bats and rodents together, you have about 75% of all mammals. So those two groups are huge. But yeah, over 1,000 species of bats all around the world. Now, next question is, where are they? So we're going to come at that from a different angle. How many in Iowa? So if there's 1,000 around the world, try and do some math here and figure out how many are there in Iowa. Okay, now I'm going to stop you before you do too much math. Iowa did get kind of shortchanged. We don't have, you know, if you just divide up the surface of the land area on Earth into 1,000, that doesn't work. Because where does the vast majority of these species live? The tropics, yeah. So by the time you get away from the tropics, there's far fewer. So by the time we're here in Iowa, we have 9 of them that are regular residents, and another 2 that just pop in from time to time. Okay, and I'll show you a little bit about each of those guys. Okay, here's our next quiz question. Who is their closest relative among the other mammals? Okay, and people all the time refer to bats as flying rats. Next time you hear somebody say that, thump them upside the head. I'm not going to thump you upside the head. but because they're actually not even remotely related to rodents. Now, they're mammals, they're all mammals, so from that standpoint, they're related. Their closest living relatives are shrews. Shrews are very common around here. They're mouse-sized critters. If you look at their skull structure, their tooth structure, their DNA structure, bats are actually very closely related to shrews. What's interesting is the bat and shrew group is actually much closer in relationship to the primates than they are to rodents. So you're literally more accurate calling a bat a flying human than you are calling it a flying rodent, but yet people call them that all the time. Okay, so that's just one of the many misconceptions about bats. Okay, now, they're small. The largest bat on Earth weighs 2 pounds. That's as much as your standard fox squirrel that we have here in Iowa. That's the largest in the world. The average bat on Earth weighs in at about the weight of one car key. Okay, so in the vicinity of about 15 grams or so. So they're small critters, but yet they have very big impacts on ecosystems. Okay, that is Myotis auriculus. I don't even know its common name, to tell you the truth. It's a western bat. This is not an Iowa bat, but we do have 3 bats in Iowa that are this size. Okay, so yeah, we have eastern pipistrelles or tri-colored bats is their new names. And then the Indiana bat and the northern long-eared bat are all in this same size range. Okay, so here's your next quiz question. Bats have 3 main impacts on ecosystems, and you can think of these as beneficial roles that they play. What are those impacts? Okay, so they are the dominant controller of night flying insects. Okay, there are very few other organisms out there that have as big of an impact on night flying insects as they do. Okay, that's one.
Pollination.
Okay, extremely important pollinators, especially once you get down to the tropics. The estimates are that in the New World tropics, so Central and South America, somewhere in the vicinity of 30% or so of all plants are pollinated mostly by bats. Okay, we got one more. No, not really. I mean, that's such a localized impact. It certainly has an impact, but it's so localized it doesn't end up having that big of an impact overall. There's a whole bunch of them that eat fruit. Why are fruit-eating organisms important? Because they disperse the seeds. They move seeds around. Bats are hugely important in terms of moving seeds around. Research in Africa has shown that if you have rainforest in an area, you go into the center of it and you cut out an area of rainforest and then you measure the trees that come back in, the seeds that come back in, about 90% of the initial round of seed fall into that area is from bats. So very important as in terms of seed moving. Okay, so major predators of insects, important pollinators, and seed dispersers. Okay, now here's our overall design. And so essentially what bats are is they have really, really long arms. Okay, they've simply extended the length of the arms, especially the lengths of the fingers have dramatically increased. Now, do you have, I meant to bring my little laser pointer and I forgot it. You even have a laser pointer? Wow, this is a high-tech place. But I'll give you a little bit but while she's getting that. So great big long arms, then you stretch a thin sheet of skin across that, you connect the skin down to the back feet, and then you connect across to the tail. So essentially you just get a kite is more or less what you have. Okay, that sheet of skin is probably 10 cells or so thick, and it's tougher than you think. You can push on it pretty hard and you won't poke your finger through it. It's got a lot of elasticity to it. Now they will get holes. In fact, this bat has a little hole there in the right back edge of the wing, and they'll seal those up pretty easily. And it occasionally we'll catch bats with great big tears, and I'm often amazed by how much of damage they can survive to those wings. I once caught a big brown bat that had literally the whole outer half of the wing was completely separate from the inner half. There's just this huge V-shaped tear. But yet this was an old bat, and she had a belly full of food and was just smiling at me. I mean, it didn't apparently hurt her too much. Okay, but the other thing to look at here is just the overall design. Look at the shoulder size. Look at the size of the muscles there in the shoulders and the chest. So just enormous upper body and tiny little hips. Now, if you've ever seen picture of Arnold Schwarzenegger back in his bodybuilding days, he was that exact same design, huge up above and just tiny little hips, same design.
Now, don't they have little finger spurs out there in the middle too?
Yes, there are little thumbs sticking up. And you can see, though, especially the one on the left-hand side, that literally is its thumb sticking up, and it has a little claw on it, and so they can crawl with that. Then the first two fingers are stuck right next to each other, and they run along the front edge of the wing. Okay, then you can see a finger coming down at kind of an angle towards my hand. That's the ring finger, and then coming straight down is the pinky. So you can essentially see it's thumb sticking up, pinky straight down, these two guys together, so something along those lines. And the fingers are really long, especially the middle finger. The middle finger is approximately almost two times longer than the radius and the ulna are, the forearm are. So imagine taking your middle finger and making it two times longer than that length. So just really long fingers, and then this cool sheet of skin that wraps across. Now something else, actually I might be almost tall enough to reach this, I think. No, not quite. But if you look at the tail membrane, which is that hunk right up there that connects the two back feet and then encloses the tail, you'll notice that there are strips of muscle going across that. Can you see the strips that are parallel to each other? So they have a lot of control over the shape of that structure. And there are also strips of muscle out in the wing also. You can see that same color and again the parallel strips out in there. So they have a lot of control over the shape of the wings and the tail. You can also see blood vessels out in there as well. So not surprisingly, any living tissue has to have a blood supply to it. So there's the overall design. So great big wings and then that cool sheet of skin that connects the tail or connects the feet to each other, what's called the tail membrane. The tail membrane is basically what I like to refer to as their baseball glove. Most of the insects that are caught are actually caught in the tail membrane. They will literally knock an insect down with their wing and then scoop it up with the tail membrane. And that all makes sense if you think about that from the standpoint of why wouldn't you just catch them in your mouth? Why does that create a problem? Because what else do they do with their mouth when they're flying around? They make sounds so they can hear the echolocation sounds. You can't do much echolocating if you've got a mouth full of bugs. Thank you very much. Okay. No, we don't. Their echolocation calls are above our hearing frequency. Now there is a kind of bat that lives way out in the western portions of the U.S. whose echolocation calls are in fact audible, but the vast majority of them are far above our hearing range. Okay, but there's that little hole I was telling you about, and then you can see, so there's the thumb sticking straight up. This whole little mass right there, that's the palm of the hand basically. And so then the middle finger starts right here and then it comes out and actually you can't see it, but in fact it kind of bends right there and it ends up coming out here and ending all the way out there. So you can get a sense, especially that middle finger is twice as long as the radius and the ulna are. Okay? I think so. I mean, of course, most of the time when they're crawling around in a tree, they've got it all folded up because it folds up very nicely. But we do fairly common. I mean, to catch them with holes in their wings is super common. So I'm going to guess mostly that is coming from, you know, getting brushed up too close against a tree branch or something like that and just hooking a little piece on it. I'm going to guess that periodically there are catastrophic mistakes that they die from, but of course that's the kind of thing as a biologist you almost never see. But you can see in this guy, there's a little, see that little white dot? That's a healed scar. There's a healed scar there, and in fact I just noticed he has a second little hole right there. So they get all sorts of little holes popped into the wings. Okay, now, one of the beauties of nature always is, what's the basic pattern, and then what are some of the different variations off of that? So here we've got a cool little bat who has no tail membrane. Why would you not have a tail membrane? If you're not eating insects. Yeah. And this actually, if you look, it's got kind of a long snout, and then his tongue is about three times longer than his head is. What do you think he's eating? He's a nectar feeder. So he comes up and hovers in front of flowers and sticks that tongue down into the flower to pull the nectar out. So that's a nectar feeder from down in the southwest. I also like these two guys because they're neat just contrasts. We've got very short, very broad wings there, but this guy on the other hand has this albatross design, very long, very narrow wings. Okay, so beautiful contrast in wing design. This guy will cover 200 to 300 miles in a night. They get up very high, way above the trees, and cover long distances at relatively high speeds. This guy probably never moves any more than 1 mile from its roosting site. Very slow flyer. This bat is actually flying around in mostly in the desert southwest. It's flying in and among tree branches, and it's listening for caterpillars crawling on leaves, and then it picks them off. And if you're going to hover, you have to, most animals that hover have great big round wings. That's a good way to produce lots of lift while standing in one spot at very slow speeds. This is the Brazilian free-tailed bat. If you've seen bats in Carlsbad Caverns or in the Big Bridge in Austin, Texas, it's that species. And then this is the big-eared bat, Townsend's big-eared bat. Okay, now, one of the things that I get from people all the time about bats is, but they're so ugly. Okay, so here we go. Let's talk a little bit about ugly bats. Here is our big-eared bat again. Okay, and so is he ugly? Well, all right, I suppose. But to me, what you always find in biology is, yes, things may be ugly by our standards, but if you understand how they work, they now become beautiful. Okay, and so this is the dude who is now listening for caterpillars crawling across leaves and listening for caterpillars chewing on leaves. You have to have phenomenal hearing to do that. In particular, especially given the fact that your own wings are making noise. So you have to be able to pick out those sounds away from your own noise. So you've got the gigantic ears to be able to pick up just the slightest little sounds. Now the other cool thing on this bat, you've got this little horn that sticks up there on either side, and the whole face is basically naked. And that threw biologists for a little while. What they then did, though, was to take a little can of colored smoke and just blow little puffs of smoke right at the face of this bat. And what they found was that all of these little knobs are acting to funnel sound right into those ears. So that you find that a lot with bats. A lot of the weird little wrinkles and knobs and stuff are all funnels to try and get sound right into the ears. And you don't want a whole lot of hair sticking up there and slowing down the sound as it's coming into your ears. Okay, so again, it's beauty by design. Now, this next bat, I'm going to wait for a second to show you this picture. This next bat, my wife had come with me. We were in Costa Rica. My wife is very good at and has been helping me do research on bats for years. To get a bat out of a mist net, which is how we catch them, is an art form. And she has done this a lot. She's one of the best people I've ever seen in terms of getting bats out of mist nets. So she's working on a bat on the far side of this little area, which is like a long drinking pool that was actually initially set up for cattle. But then the cattle are gone, and now the bats just come down and drink out of this. So she's working on the one side. I'm working on a bat on the other side. And she starts saying things like, oh man, this is an ugly bat. And then I see her kind of hold it up closer and put it into her headlight, and she goes, it looks like he was in a horrible car accident. As soon as she said that, I knew who it was. It was a bat I had always wanted to see. And in the years since, we've now caught 7 or 8 of them. And this is the wrinkle-faced bat. And so yeah, just about as ugly as it gets. In fact, it's kind of hard to tell where the mouth is. You want to say, well, that's it right there, but it isn't. The mouth is actually down here, okay? So again, biologists had no idea what this was all about until somebody one day looked at its poop and said, okay, it's a fruit eater, so that gives us a hint. And then what they also found was, based on the seeds that were coming out of the poop, was it eats big fruits. Most of the fruit-eating bats will hover in front of a small fruit, grab it with their teeth, and pop it off of the tree, and then fly away somewhere. This guy was actually eating big fruits. So now what they have since discovered that this bat does, he lands on a big fruit, he's got great big thumbs with long claws, he hangs on, and he just starts munching on it. Most of its food actually comes from the fruit juice. If you take an eyedropper and put a drip of fluid up there, the wrinkles direct it right down into the mouth. No matter where you put a drip of fluid on that face, the wrinkles lead it right down to the mouth. And of course, if you're trying to drink fruit juice, you don't want a whole bunch of hair. Not only does that slow down the fruit juice coming into your mouth, but now the hair gets matted with sugars, and now it's got bacteria growing there. So yes, it's probably the ugliest animal on earth, but it's beautiful in its own way. Now what's also fun about this, and you can't really see it, well, you can kind of see it. He's got an extra flap of skin there, all covered with fur. When he sleeps during the day, that whole piece of skin lifts up and over and actually comes all the way up to there and covers almost the whole ear. So when you see these guys roosting during the day, you just see a ball of fur. You can't even see that face. So just to me, I mean, that's absolutely beautiful animal, even though it's not. And then, by the way, its wingspan is about that. So it's kind of a standard bat. No, they are not. In fact, you can get a sense from this. I mean, they're not blind at all. Yeah. That I know of, there is not a bat on earth that is blind. The thought is that they have decent nighttime vision. It's not great vision, probably somewhat equivalent to our nighttime vision. But it's always very hard to look at an animal's eyes and literally know exactly what it's seeing. You can look at the microscopic structure at the back of the eye and compare it to ours. And then when you do that, you find that their eye structure actually is very similar to ours. So probably seeing about like what we do, only black and white vision, which is pretty standard in most mammals. Is it double? No. But what they have is, almost all bats have, I keep losing the little button, almost all bats have a little sliver of skin that sticks up into the ear. It's called the tragus. If you feel right here, you actually have an anti-tragus because it's starting at the front edge of your ear and coming back. They have at the back edge of their ear coming in a tragus. Okay, in this bat, the tragus, for some reason, sticks way out here and lays across there. So that's just an extra little structure within the ear. Nobody's really sure why it's tragus, because no other bat on earth has a tragus that lays inside like that. So nobody's sure what that's all about. Okay, now, where do they roost? If you ask Joe Public where do they roost, what are they going to say? They're going to say buildings and caves. But that's only scratching the surface. Yes, we do have buildings, and yes, we do have caves, but the number one roost is a variety of hollow trees. Okay, they love hollow trees. They'll use abandoned woodpecker holes too. A dead tree that has the bark that's starting to peel off, they love to get up underneath that. So those are the main roosts. We have a number of bats locally that actually roost out in the leaves, and they're colored like a dead leaf. And so you just walk right by them. You don't even know you're walking by a bat. Other important places, this is kind of a fun one. There's been a number of times when I've been walking along, you know, rocky faces along a creek, and there's always lots of little cracks that go back in there, and you kind of lean up against it, and you make some noise, and you'll hear a scream coming from inside that little crevice. So I've several times heard them roosting in those kinds of places. So they roost in a whole bunch of places depending upon the bat. This particular group right here, this is one of the little groups of fruit eaters down in the tropics that build tent leaves. They get into these huge banana leaves or other plants that have great big leaves. They snip a whole bunch of the veins on either side so that the leaf collapses down. Then they roost underneath. And this is one of my nemesis. I don't know what the plural of nemesis is. Every time I go down to the tropics, I tell the kids, okay, every time we find a leaf that is collapsed down like that, look, one of these days we're going to find leaf nose or these leaf roosting bats, and we haven't seen them yet, but it'll happen. Okay, now, a little bit about what bats are doing right now, or what they should be doing right now. They're not doing it this year, but of our 9 species that are regular here, 5 of them migrate. A couple of them migrate so far south that they're actually able to be active all year round. But what a lot of them do is migrate further south to places where they can hibernate. Okay, and so there's a number of them that migrate to big caves down in central Missouri, all the way down to northern Arkansas. There's a whole bunch of caves down in that area. So a good chunk of our bats are migrants. But we do have 4 species that hibernate here locally. Okay, and those 4 species are big brown bats, little brown bats, the tri-colored bat, and the northern long-eared bat. All 4 of those guys hibernate right here locally. Some of those are roosting or are hibernating in houses, but some of them hibernate again in those kinds of places I already talked about, the crevices in a rocky face. And you don't have to have, you know, big cliffs to have those kinds of things. Even a cliff that's like 6 feet high will have little cracks that go back into it. And we certainly have those in the sandstone, the limestone around here. Now, during hibernation, it's important that the hibernation spot, what they refer to as the hibernaculum, has to be cold, but it can't be too cold. If it's too cold, a bat can't let its body temperature drop below freezing. They want a body temperature of 33 to about 50 degrees Fahrenheit. If they can't cool down enough, then they're burning too much energy. If they cool down too much, then they're burning too much energy to stay warm. So it has to be at that happy medium. When they hit that happy medium, everything slows way down. So that a bat whose heart is pounding 1,200 beats per minute in flight now drops down to about 20 beats per minute during hibernation. So just an incredible decline. Because they've slowed down so much, even a little bat, like a little brown bat, which cannot put that much fat on, they can still slow down so much that they can hibernate for 9 straight months without feeding, which is just amazing to think about. Now, one of our local bats, the big brown bat, is doing something. Nobody knows what's going on here, but during hibernation, male big brown bats will wake up, they'll walk around in the cave, and they'll mate with the females who are still sound asleep in hibernation. So nobody's really sure, is this a common occurrence? Is this a really rare occurrence? Is it maybe an old male bat who's starting to run out of energy and somehow or another knows, I'm not going to make it until spring, so I'm just going to do what I can to try and spread my genes? Or the other thought is, maybe it's the great big fat boys, the guys who are so healthy that they know they can get up and do this several times throughout their winter and still survive till spring. So some weird stuff going on there. Nobody knows exactly what's happening with it yet. This is one of the things that makes bats so much fun. You talk about sex and animals to a bunch of college students, man, you've got their attention. Okay, a little bit on bat catching. One of the fun things about being a bat catcher is that there are not many of us. There are very few bat researchers around the world. The majority of them that are present in the places with lots and lots of bats. So out here in the Midwest, I'm the only bat catcher in Iowa. There is a guy in the DNR who does some work, but almost all of his work is with me. So I'm basically the only bat catcher in Iowa. I do work in Nebraska too, and now there's a second person who also does work in Nebraska. So there's just very few people who do this. Largely because they're very hard to catch, and you almost never can get big numbers. It's hard to get big enough numbers to really do some serious science on them. So I think that combination makes it that most folks don't do it. But what we use are nets, and so it's a little bit hard to see, but I've got a pole going up 30 feet in the air here, and there's nets going across it. Here is the net. The net is designed to be very fine so that if the bat is simply using eyesight, it won't notice it. We also have setups that allow us to just put nets up that high. So I don't always use this gigantic system. A lot of times I just use these little poles. And so the bats that are flying around, you try and find places where you think bats are likely to fly. And then they get caught in here and they get tangled. So it doesn't hurt them, but you do have to get out fairly quickly to get them out because they'll chew holes. And they'll either chew holes that they really tangle themselves, so you end up cutting the heck out of the net to get them out, or they'll actually just chew holes and they'll be gone. And so you'll go there and there's a big hole in your net and no bat. Occasionally we'll get ourselves in the situation where there's a whole bunch of bats and they're all coming out of one small spot. And in that case, we don't want to run our net because our net would just get loaded with 120 bats and that's a mess. That's 5 hours worth of work to get them all out of there. So in that case, we use this thing. This is what's called a harp trap. And there's just fishing line going up and down. And the bats try and fly in between the fishing line, and there's another set of fishing line on the other side, and they hit that, and they just kind of bounce back and forth, and then there's a plastic bag down here at the bottom that catches them. And so you just sit out here and wait for the sound, and then reach down in there and pull them out of the bag. And that's a lot of fun if you get the right spot. We often set this up and think, okay, the bats are coming out of here. We sit there right at sunset, and boom, all of a sudden the bats are flying over our heads, coming out of a hole in a barn that we didn't even know existed. So we oftentimes set that up and just sit there and look and watch and figure, oh, well, the bats beat us tonight. But it's a lot of fun to do. I do this a lot during the summer. This summer I'll be going out. Right now I know of about 25 nights that we'll be doing some work in southern Iowa. In fact, not too far south of here. Okay, now what I want to do is kind of quickly zip through. Go ahead. In this particular case, wherever I set them here, learn from this, that didn't catch a thing. This was a very hard place. Every once in a while, we do some of these surveys associated with construction projects. If somebody's using tax money to go in and mow down a bunch of trees to do some sort of construction project, and if they're within the geographic distribution of the Indiana bat, the endangered species that lives here in Iowa, they have to survey to see if the bat is there. And so they hire me and some students to go out and survey. Sometimes we get to these places and there is just no place to catch bats. And so we'll sit for a night and just watch them flying, and then we'll just say, well, I don't know what else to do, so we're going to slap a net there. So we put this one up just kind of thinking, well, there were a lot of bats flying there. I thought, oh, there's no way it's ever going to catch a bat, and it didn't. Most of the time what we look for are flight paths. If you find a road that's cutting through the woods, bats will be zipping up and down that. The best are streams that wander through woods, because the streams will create a little flyway above the stream, and bats will zip up and down that. They're drinking regularly from the water, and plus which a lot of the insects that bats eat actually live underwater as immature insects and then come out and fly around in the air as adults. And those are important bat food. So that's the best place to set up nets. But every once in a while, you're just kind of forced to slap up a net anywhere and just see what happens. And that normally doesn't work out very well. Yeah, but that's actually another reason that you don't have too many bat catchers. Because the best bat netting places, you're in that much water and generally around here about that much mud. The mosquitoes are just covering you, but the bats are there. And so you have to go into those kinds of places if you're going to have any luck. Okay, now, our local bats. So what I'm going to do is just kind of quickly fly through our local species here and just showing you some of the ones that some of these you have seen, I mean, whether you know it or not, and other ones you may not have. This is the most commonly encountered bat in Iowa. This is the big brown bat. Super common across the state, and it uses buildings very heavily. And so that combination means that people encounter them. How many of you have encountered bats in your house, in a church, in a high school gymnasium? Probably all of you. It's always this guy. Now, that's not entirely true. If you get up in north of I-80, you'll periodically get into places where the next bat, the little brown bat, gets into houses. But down here, it's almost always big browns. This is a decent-sized bat. This is a bat who weighs about a car key to a car key and a half in weight and has a wingspan of about 12 inches across or so. They are mostly beetle eaters, and they're actually very important from an agricultural standpoint because they eat the adults of either corn rootworm or corn borer. I don't remember which. One of those is a moth, the other one's a beetle. And whichever one is the beetle, this guy eats a whole bunch of. It also eats those spotted cucumber beetles, the little yellow guys with the black dots over them. And those are an important agricultural pest. It eats lots of those. Okay, all the way across the United States and all of Iowa, so super common bat. Now in this case, what we've got here is they are actually roosting underneath bridges. One of the things we've discovered is that bats will go out right after sunset and feed for about an hour or 2 hours. They get their belly absolutely crammed with food. They go someplace warm to sit and digest. Underneath concrete bridges, where the concrete bridge has just been sitting there baking in the sun all day, it's hot if you get up underneath there, and they like it hot when they're sitting and trying to digest food. And so in this case, there's actually been so many of them sitting on this girder underneath this bridge that they've actually stained the girder brown with their poop and their pee and their oils and all that kind of stuff. So this is an easy bat to study because you can catch big numbers of them underneath bridges. Okay, now, this guy, the little brown bat, another extremely common bat. Here in the southern third of the state, they're very patchy in distribution. We'll net for 10, 12 nights and never catch one. But if we catch one, I always tell the students, as soon as we catch the first one, get ready, because here they come. And when you're in their area, boy, you'll just get the nets loaded with these guys. Here you can see there's probably 40 of them or so crammed into. There was actually, this was two pieces of plywood laying against each other in a barn, and they were crammed up inside that. This barn had 300 or 400 of them in there, just huge numbers. And so when you do get little browns, you often get giant numbers. There are some barns and some churches up in the northern parts of Iowa that literally have tens of thousands of these guys roosting in there. These guys eat a lot of small, soft-bodied insects, especially they eat insects that are aquatic. So you tend to find these guys most commonly near big rivers. Okay, and so we find them in places right along the Des Moines, right along the Skunk Rivers. And you'll occasionally get barns with lots of them in there. Okay, to tell a little brown bat from a big brown bat, now that I've seen 1,000 of each, I can do it just like that. But the first couple of times you look at them, they're a challenge to tell apart. This guy is half the body weight of a big brown bat, but their wingspan is almost the same. And so when you're holding their wings open, you're thinking it's about the same size. But as soon as you then start looking at the body, you realize, oh no, it's actually much smaller.
Is insecticide
Say that again?
Is insecticide
yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm.
Right, Yeah, there has been quite a bit of work showing that any kind of an insecticide that immediately kills insects is generally not a problem. But the ones that take several days to kill an insect, they start showing up in the blood of these guys, they show up in the breast milk of these guys and are transferred to the babies. Yeah, and there's no doubt that it has caused health problems in certain instances in these guys. There are some other chemicals, though, that seem to build up in these guys and don't appear to have any influence. And so we see that same kind of thing in humans. It's sometimes hard to tell which chemicals are going to cause problems and which don't.
Why are they all crammed in there?
They love heat. And in this case, it was moms and babies. Babies will grow much faster if the air temperature around them is 95 or 100 degrees. And so a lone female sitting there with her babies will take 3-4 days more to develop to the point where they're ready to fly, as opposed to if they're now sitting massed into, a whole bunch of bats and all that collective body heat. Milk, yeah, the same. Yeah, they have two mammary glands, and when the female is back roosting, the young are nursing away. She will not carry them with her in flight, so they just sit in the roost and wait for her to come back. It depends. There are two species locally that have four babies and they have four mammary glands. Okay, but all of the ones that have two mammary glands either have one or two babies per year. Yeah, almost all bats reproduce very slowly.
Mm-hmm.
No idea. There's a whole bunch of these things that what bats do once they're out flying around is anybody's guess. Because we don't have cameras small enough to ride on their backs, and we just have no clue. So my guess is throughout the course of this talk, you'll probably ask me 3 or 4 questions, and I'll just kind of go, we have no idea. And that's one of them.
What's the gestation period?
Hang on to that question, because I have another quiz for you. Okay, now I got to hurry here, because I don't want to spend too much time. This is my favorite little dude, the Indiana bat. And so this is our federally endangered species. You find it pretty much south of I-80 in the central and the eastern parts of the state. By the time you get into the southwestern quarter, they just barely creep into that southwestern corner of Iowa. They don't make it all the way to the Nebraska border. Great little bat, very mild-mannered bat. You find them both in upland forests as well as the riparian forest right down along creeks. By the way, I said mild-mannered. Some of the bats are really feisty. And so when you're holding them, they're yelling at you. You put your finger in there, and you're going to pull back something bleeding. This guy is very mild-mannered. It very rarely makes any noise. They'll open their mouth to try and look mean, but if you put your finger in there, they don't even bite. So beautiful little bat, and a lot of fun to work with. What's interesting about them is although they are a forest bat, they actually reach their highest numbers in areas that have about an even mix of open country, regardless of what that open country is, and forests. And so we find these guys very common, especially if you get a little bit further south in Iowa. That southern two tiers of counties, you get a lot of mix of woods and pastures and woods and cornfields, and there's lots of Indiana bats down there. These guys roost in standing dead trees. And so that seems to be one of the real keys. If you find an older forest with lots of standing dead trees, you can pretty much guarantee you're going to catch an Indiana bat or two in there. And these guys also, again, feed a lot over water and are eating a lot of these little soft-bodied insects. We have, and these guys also hibernate in a couple of caves. In fact, every Indiana bat in Iowa appears to hibernate probably in two caves in northeastern Missouri. And that's actually one of the things that makes this species endangered. Across the entire United States, the entire species, they all hibernate in about 9 caves. So if anything happens to a couple of those caves, you've just lost 30% of the population of the whole species. So it's a very vulnerable species from that standpoint. Okay, this is one of the dudes that I've done a lot of work on, and so here's one that we've caught. We've put a little wing band on it. In fact, we've put wing bands on 95 of them now. And just 2 weeks ago, I just heard that they finally found one of our wing-banded bats in a cave down in Missouri. That also gives you a sense for how few bat researchers there are. If we've banded almost 100 of them now over the course of the last 5 years, and now they've just found one. Because it's kind of a needle in a haystack searching for a bat with a band on it. But this one also, we shave a little patch of skin between the shoulder blades, and then we use surgical glue, and we glue on a radio transmitter. So we've done quite a bit of work tracking these guys, trying to figure out where they're roosting. Are they using buildings? Are they using bridges? So it's been a lot of fun. And basically what we found is that they don't use buildings much. They use bridges a little bit to roost underneath at night. But by and large, they're just sticking to the trees. Okay, another one of my favorites, the northern long-eared bat. The fun thing about this guy, he's got huge ears, which you can kind of see from this picture here. This is another bat that weighs in at about the weight of a nickel. So tiny little bat. And what's fun about it is it eats lots of spiders. It's one of the few insects or bats around here that will fly up to a spider web, hover in front of the spider web, find the spider, and then pick it out, and then fly away. They also pick caterpillars off of leaves. We've watched them picking. If you go into a barn at night, there's a bunch of flies that roost up on the walls. They'll go in there and just pick the flies off one at a time from the walls on the inside of the barns. So this is a neat bat. They're all the way across the state, but we normally don't catch very big numbers of them at any one spot. And this is another one hanging from the underneath. It's a wasp's nest in underneath a bridge. You can kind of see there's one of the big girders underneath the bridge in the background. Okay, eastern red bat, another very common bat. This is one of the ones that roosts out in the leaves of trees. This is another one that you'll see right here in town. My wife and I go quite often there in Pella to the Thursday night celebrations that happen in the summertime. And right at sunset, you'll see bats flying around over your head, and it's still light enough that you can tell that they're red. And so you know you're seeing eastern red bats. But these guys have really short little ears, and they have lots of fur. The wings actually start, so the body is ending right there and right there. And so the inner portions of the wings are actually completely furred. This is all telling you that this guy is not roosting in a warm place. It roosts out in leaves, and because it's sitting out there in spring and fall, it's exposed to pretty darn cold temperatures. So it's got a body shape that's really telling you that it's trying to stay warm on cold nights. But a beautiful bat, especially males. Males are this beautiful brick red. Females are good-looking bats too, but they're more of a kind of a brownish red. Okay, the biggest bat in Iowa is the hoary bat. And that spelling just means it's like a hoar frost, and it's just referring to kind of a frosted appearance. And so they have this dark gray fur, but it has white tips to each hair, so it gives it kind of a frosted look. And a big female will have about an 18-inch wingspan. And so this is a decent-sized bat. They fly high, though. And so because they fly up so high, they're really hard to catch. And so in a given summer, even though we may catch 500 to 1,000 bats, we'll generally only catch 2 hoary bats. But yet, if we take one of our bat detectors and listen, we hear them all the time. They're just up there so high we can't catch them. And they make a lot of fun noises. Students, when they first catch them, they're excited because I always let the students go play with them first. But then as soon as they grab them and they make noise, they make this loud hissing noise and these loud ticks, and they're so strong. Half the time, the students just end up dropping the bat and walking away and let me take care of it. Once they get used to them, they're okay with it. But that first encounter with a hoary bat is always kind of scary. Okay, we're just going to skip through silver-haired bat, mostly because nobody knows. You catch these guys so rarely, it's really hard to know much about them. Same color, same story with the tri-colored bat. If you know much about bats, this guy used to be called the Eastern Pipistrelle. They've changed its names. This is the tri-colored bat. This is another one that I'll catch, you know, 3 of them all summer. When you catch those kinds of numbers, you just can't learn anything about the biology of the animal. You just don't catch enough of them. Okay, evening bat, this is another one that you don't catch that commonly. The fun thing I love about evening bats is, notice it says, hard to identify, use your nose. Picture this, go to the dentist, have a tooth drilled at the dentist. You know that smell? Can you picture that smell in your head, the smell of drilling teeth? That's what they smell like. It's uncanny. There's a little bit of muskiness to it that makes it, you know, not perfect, but it's really similar to that smell. So that's evening bats. By the way, lots of mammals use chemicals to communicate with each other and to spread information. So that smell, and a lot of bats do have a smell, they're saying, I'm an evening bat, I'm a male, I'm reproductively active, or it's I'm an evening bat, I'm a female, but I'm already pregnant, so save your time and energy. They can send a lot of information through chemicals. Okay, and then here's our two bats that just periodically bounce into the state. We've got the Mexican free-tailed bat here. Again, this is that same guy at Carlsbad Caverns. And because they can cover such long distances, There's a breeding colony down in extreme southwestern Kansas, and so those guys will just periodically get up and wander, especially late summer, and so they pop into the state every once in a while. Same story here. The other one that we occasionally have is this guy, the big free-tailed bat. Super long wings. This is a bat now with about a 2-foot wingspan, and they can cover, 600-700 miles in a night without an awful lot of difficulty. So those kinds of things, you just regularly find them popping into weird places. Both of them are pretty darn ugly bats, but again, are really cool if you understand why they're ugly. Okay, now, a second here. I want to watch our time. Okay, let's do a little bit on this. You've maybe heard a bit about this fungus that is going on right now. Let's spend a couple of seconds talking about this. So it's referred to as the white nose fungus, and it basically impacts bats when they're hibernating in caves. It doesn't do much during the summer. You can go into those same caves in summer and there's not a sign of the fungus. It's a winter fungus. And what it does to the bat is it invades their skin. It can damage their wings to the point where they can't fly, but even if it doesn't do that, it just wakes them up, and it wakes them up so commonly during hibernation that they burn up all their fat. And of our local species, the ones that are the most impacted is the little brown bat, our northern long-eared bat, and then that tricolored. These two bats, little brown and northern long-eared bat, just to give you a sense for this, 10 years ago were probably two of the most common bats across the whole eastern half of the United States. They have both just been listed as threatened, or they've been proposed to be listed as threatened species. And that's just in 5 years. That gives you how strong of an impact that this fungus has. Just a little bit more. Here's a hole. This is a cave, and those are just piles of dead bats laying on the floor. There's still a lot that's unknown. We've learned a bit more here the last couple of years, so we know a little bit more, but it's still kind of hard to know what's going to happen with this. Some of these caves that are really hit hard, you lose 90-95% of the bats in them. The thought is we've lost about 5.5 million bats in the last 5 years from this thing. The thought is also that we're probably going to see some extinctions from this. The gray bat, the Indiana bat, and the Virginia big-eared bat are all species that hibernate in these same caves. They're all endangered species to start with, and now this fungus is going to come along, and who knows what's going to happen. Little brown bats especially are so incredibly common across the eastern half of the United States. Their populations have been reduced in about 10 or 15 states. Their populations have been reduced by 90%. So you're taking the dominant predator of night-flying insects, and you're almost removing it. And so what's this going to do to entire ecosystems? We just don't know that yet. It looks pretty certain now what happened here. This is a European fungus. It was brought here on accident by people who were cave explorers. It appears that they probably had the spores of the fungus on their shoes or something. They brought it here accidentally. Our local bats are not immune to it. You go to Europe, the same fungus is there, and the bats survive it. And so it's tough to say what's going to happen here. Here is a map showing you this. Red circle right there is where it was first detected in 2006, and now here is essentially all of the known locations. The one little glimmer of good news is in, what year is this, 2009, 2010, there were three cases that were found out here. When that happened, everybody was thinking, this is going to spread all the way across the U.S., this is going to be enormous. But in the years since 2010 and then this winter, it has not shown up there again. So I'm starting to get a little bit more optimistic that maybe this is going to confine itself to the Northeast. Still gigantic impacts, but it would be much bigger if it spread all the way across the U.S. And maybe there's some hints that that's not going to happen now. But that's bad news. Okay. A little bit on wind turbines. Wind turbines are great. I'm intending to put up a wind turbine on our house, but they do kill bats. And we have to accept that, and we have to look at ways to get around it. In particular, red bats, hoary bats, and silver-haired bats, they get hammered by them. Every single turbine that has ever been looked at has had at least a few dead bats underneath it. In some cases, extreme cases, you'll get 1,000 bats per year killed by a turbine. The thought is right now that these species maybe breed. What they do is they fly around exposed trees out in the middle of pastures. That's how they find mates. they may be mistaking these wind turbines out in open areas for exposed trees where they're trying to find mates. That's the thought as to maybe what's happening. Now, some good news that came out just recently, some fairly simple changes to how the turbines are operated can actually have a dramatic reduction in bat mortality. I think there are solutions to this. I think ultimately we'll get down to, I don't think we'll ever stop mortalities, but I think we'll get to the point where they're so low that they're probably not having an overall impact. But right now we're not there. What I think is funny though is none of the wind people ever even mention this. They just talk about how this is the greatest, the cleanest source of energy, and they don't bring this up. And that hurts to me. I mean, well, it hurts to me because I do think it's an amazing source of energy. We just have to get over this problem is what we've got to do. Now, let's do just a couple of seconds here with bats and rabies, because tons of misunderstanding here. Couple of things. Recent changes have made it so that we can now study rabies much better in bats. We now have DNA techniques, way to identify the DNA of the virus, so you can test live bats to see if they have the virus in them. In the past, you had to kill the bat, and you had to take a brain sample to figure out if it had the disease. And so you couldn't do that in lots of cases. It was always hard to go in and take a sample of 300 bats knowing that you're going to kill them all. And so now that we can just identify it in live animals, it's changed a lot. We don't mess around with it because it's almost always fatal. And so what I always tell people is know the reality. The reality is that you are literally more likely to be killed by your lawnmower than you are by a bat with rabies. And so the likelihood of getting rabies from bats is phenomenally small, but it's essentially always fatal. And so it's just like everything else. Once you learn the realities, you take a few precautions, and then you don't panic because there's no need to panic. But a couple of just key little points. Bats don't carry the virus any more often than other mammals. For a while, it was thought that bats carry, you know, that 50% of all bats have rabies. Wrong. Okay, that idea went out in the 50s, but you still hear people talking about that number. Okay, so we now know it's more like 1 out of 500 or 1 out of 1,000 bats will have rabies. Bats don't go through that excitable stage, the mad dog stage. You know, most animals that get rabies get angry, they run around, they bite things, and then they die. Bats simply fall to the ground, they get weak, and they die. Okay? Most of the people who have gotten rabies from bats have been people who have been handling them. So that simply means, simplest thing, just don't mess with them, and your likelihood of getting rabies from a bat is almost zero. Okay? But again, since it is a fatal disease, if you've been bitten, either have the bat tested or just start into the shots. Okay, the shots are not painful. This is another thing. The shots have not been painful since the 1970s somewhere, but yet people still think they're the really painful shots into the stomach. It's not the 70s, but it's been a long time since that changed. They're just standard old shots in the arm. I've gone through the series 3 times now. I'm actually due to go through it again. And so it's not a big deal. So just keep this in perspective. The chances of actually getting rabies from a bat is phenomenally. I mean, literally in the US, about one person every year dies from rabies carried by bats. Whereas, 8 or 9 people die per year from lawnmower accidents. So it just keep those in perspective, but at the same time, you don't mess around. Okay, but really, bats are not any more of a concern than skunks are, or wild dogs are, or any of that kind of stuff. So you just, I don't know that answer. I mean, it is a high number. But also one of the things that happens is that doctors tend to do knee-jerk reactions and give shots in cases where they probably don't need to. That's probably okay, except that it leads to then this misconception that the problem's actually much worse than it seems. I've actually talked to entire families where the whole family went through the series of rabies shots because they found a bat in the house. Not because somebody was bit, because they found a bat in the house. That's just stupid, yeah. Okay, let's finish this up here with just a couple of cool tropical bats. Just because, again, you've got this idea of weird bats. This is a good-sized guy. This is a guy with about a 2.5-foot wingspan, big fruit eater. I always thought he just had kind of a face like a dog. This is the funnel-eared bat, weird-looking little thing. Insect eater, nobody really knows an awful lot about it. And then this is actually that's Trachops. It's a frog eater. So it listens for the sounds that frogs make when they're singing to each other. It then comes in and grabs the males and eats them. It's pretty decent size. It's got about 1.5-foot wingspan or so. The frogs that it are eating are small, though. It's not eating bullfrogs. In fact, bullfrogs would very happily eat it. Okay, now one quick comment. Our little nose leaf. What's the function of the nose leaf? Can you make any guesses? radar dish, but why would it be attached to the nose? You're right, though. Right now, I'm making sound with my vocal cords, and it's coming out of my mouth, but that's not the way you have to do it. Some critters make sound with the vocal cords, and it comes out their nose. These bats actually shoot the sound out through their nose. That thing lays forward to kind of concentrate all the sound right out in front of them. Yeah, so this whole group of bats is referred to, they're all referred to as the nasal emitters. Okay, so there is that. Now, let's do a couple of questions, but first we have to come back to the question of the gestation period. So I have a puzzle for you, and you have to help me solve this puzzle. Okay, ready? Bats mate in from August through October is when the majority of mating occurs. Okay? Next piece of information you need to know is from the time the baby starts developing, it takes 1 month for the baby to develop to the point where it's ready to be born. Okay? Babies are born in April and May. So how does that work? If you're mating in late summer, it only takes a month for development, but then they're not being born until April or May. What's that? Does hibernation affect it? Yes. More details, please.
If they're slowing down their body, then they slow down the development.
Okay. There are two options. They are either, bats either use what's referred to as delayed fertilization or delayed implantation. Okay, so in the first strategy, the female simply stores the sperm until the following spring, then somewhere in early, mid-April, some little hormonal bell rings in her body, she releases the sperm, fertilization occurs, then the baby takes off. Okay, or the other option is fertilization occurs right away, but now the embryo just gets to what's called the blastula stage, which is just a little microscopic round ball of cells, and it just floats in her uterus, but it doesn't actually attach to the walls of the uterus. Again, somewhere in April, that little ball now attaches into the walls of the uterus and starts to develop. So there's actually a fair number of mammals that use this strategy for mating at a time of year when there's tons and tons of energy, so the adults have lots of energy to court each other and all that kind of stuff, but yet then you don't have babies born right in the middle of winter, which would be, of course, disastrous. Okay, but did you notice that I did stick in that one little trick? That one little statement, once the baby starts developing. So I didn't lie to you, I simply breezed past that section hoping you wouldn't hear it. Okay, now I do have one more question for you and then I'll open it up to questions for you. How long do bats live? And I'll give you a hint.
I'll say 16 to 18 years.
16 to 18 years, but a mouse that's that same size is gonna be really lucky if it lives to be a year old. Are you still gonna stick with your answer? Go ahead and stick to it. All right. I gave you another hint. How many babies do bats have at a time? One or two. What's the rule in mammals? The shorter your lifespan, the more babies you have at a time. So that's also telling us long lifespans. Yeah, the average lifespan for a big brown bat is probably in the 8 to 12 year range. Some individuals clearly reach into their 20s. Occasional individuals reach into their 30s. The lifespan record so far is a little brown bat that was caught, banded, and caught 33 years later. So probably very commonly 10, 15, 12 years, somewhere in that range, but occasionally much longer than that. Why? Why can they live so long, but a mouse that's the same size can't?
Hibernation
helps. A 10-year-old bat's really only been active for 5 years. That's part of the story. Who eats bats? Locally, almost nobody. Occasionally a snake will find them in a roost, occasionally a raccoon or a cat will find them in their roost, but almost nobody eats them regularly. Who eats mice? Well, where do we start that list? It's a very long list. Okay, so that combination, hibernation and the fact that very few things eat them, allows them. By the time you get down to the tropics, there are bats that eat other bats, there are falcons that eat bats, there are snakes that are bat specialists, so the lifespan decreases pretty dramatically once you get down to the tropics. And then, not surprisingly, the number of babies you have at a given time increases. Okay, give me some questions.
How many times have you been bit?
How many times have I been bit? I get bit probably every other time when I'm out in the summer. But I'm also, since I've had the rabies shots, I'm careless. I have students, the students that first start out with me wear two leather gloves, and they don't get bit. Although occasionally one of them, unbeknownst to me, will take their gloves off because working with two gloves is clumpy. And so about one out of every five students ends up needing to get the rabies shots anyways because they got bit. Although every once in a while, the other thing that happens is the leather gloves, especially big brown bats, always bite the exact same spot, so they'll get weak. And so you won't know that until all of a sudden you take your glove off and you're dripping blood. And when that happens, now you have to get the rabies shots.
How long does that last?
That's a good question. The bat biologists will tell you one thing. A doctor will tell you an entirely different thing. Bat biologists, what we do is we go in and we get a booster every 5 years once you get bit. So I'm now at the stage where I need to go in for a booster. A doctor will tell you every single time you get bit, you need to go in for the shots again, but they're carrying it overboard. The bats themselves or the rabies from them?
The
bats themselves? No, they do not. Probably they do on extremely rare instances. Almost all mammals do occasionally interbreed with each other, but it's a very rare instance. I've never actually heard of records of bats doing this. I'm going to get the bet that occasionally they do, but I think it's a very rare instance.
Do they all stay in their own area?
They certainly, you'll find several living in the same kind of general area, but then they roost in different spots. In the instances where you do find them all roosting in the same building, they're almost always, they're not almost never roosting together. Even if you go into these big caves where they're hibernating, most of the time you'll find the species will segregate by themselves. There's a couple of species that regularly bunch together, but that's kind of the fluke. Everybody else stays separate. What else? Threw a lot of information at you once. Are you at brain overload yet? Up until I talked to him, I would say no. big brown bats, which are the primary species that we have around here that uses bat houses, don't use them heavily as a rule. I think the success he's having is because he hasn't built a bat house. He's built a bat barn. I mean, it's huge. And I think he's built something so big that he's really gone into this level where it's now super attractive to them. But the average bat house doesn't, they have some success, but it's not very high. So what I always tell people is, if you've got one sitting in the garage, put it up. If you love to woodwork, build one and put it up. Don't go to Earl May and spend $110 on one because it's not worth that. But like I said, if you like to woodwork, then go ahead and try it because it's worth a try. Especially if you live near woods, especially if you live near water, then you have a better chance. But I have two bat houses up, and I just put a third up. And the two that I have up, I get two or three big browns that will use them most nights during the summer, but not all nights. I think they're just a couple of bachelor males. During most of the breeding season, males are one place, females and babies are another. Since female bats are much bigger than males, I think the males don't even want to get close to them because they get their butts kicked, is my impression. What else?
How long do they fly at night? I guess we've got a lot of bats around our farm.
Mm-hmm.
And I usually can be out at about 7 o'clock, and all of a sudden, here they come.
Right. Right. It is amazing how they'll time it very precisely. Yeah. I hate to do this to you, but it all depends on who you're talking about and what time of year it is. If it is a male during the middle of summer, a male bat during the middle of summer has nothing to do. He's not hanging out. He's not helping raise the babies. He's just doing nothing. He'll go out and feed for an hour. That's enough to keep him going through till the next night. So they'll just go out and feed for an hour. They'll come back and they'll sleep for the other 23 hours. Females who are lactating, that's kind of the ultimate in energy need. They'll feed 6 or 7 hours a night. They'll come back, they'll sit for 15 minutes, they'll digest, they'll nurse their young, then they'll go right back out again. Late summer, once everybody starts trying to pack on fat for the upcoming winter, now everybody starts increasing it. So even males now will start, cranking up and feeding 3-4 hours a night at that time of year. So it all depends on which gender you're talking about. Are they reproductively active? What time of year it is? But yeah, they're so good at catching stuff. We'll go out sometimes and catch barns, or we'll net barns. We did a bunch of work for a couple of years on barns, trying to figure out if that endangered species uses barns. We would catch big brown bats leaving right at sunset, and a half hour later, we would catch the males coming back in with just big, huge bellies full of food. It takes them almost no time to get stuff full of food. Mm-hmm.
What do you suggest to people who have bats in their house or exterminators?
Yeah, that's a challenge, especially in older houses. They only need a house, you know, a hole. Yeah. They really only know a hole about the size of a quarter. What's that? Well, as it turns out, most of the bats will stay in your walls and won't come in. The ones that you see inside are the ones that have made mistakes, you know, that have come inside instead of trying to get outside. And so what I generally recommend is if it's just one or two bats a year, live with it. If it's big numbers, I actually know a guy who lives up in Adel, and he's a bat excluder. So he'll charge you money, but he'll come down and look at your house. Actually, I think he does free estimates. And he'll try and estimate, here's how much it's going to cost to get them out. And he actually sets it up in such a way that the bats will leave, but it's a one-way gate, so they can't come back in. Then once he's done that, then he comes in and fills in the holes. A lot of times with the bat excluders, they have to come back several times because, you know, there's always more holes than you realize. Yeah. Right. But, yeah. And the other thing you can do is you can sit outside in the evenings, get two people sitting on the opposite corners of the house and just watch the two walls and try and figure out where they're coming out. And then wait until they've come out for the night and then go and plug those holes. You don't want to do this, though, during the breeding season because now you're locking babies inside. And not only is that not nice, but it's also stinky.
I would like to come out the chimney.
Some of them, well, actually, out the chimney itself, that's almost never bats. I get calls about this all the time. It's chimney swifts, which are a bird. And they actually roost in the chimneys. And then they'll, right at sunset, they're just going like crazy, coming in and coming out. And people always think they're bats, but they're almost always these birds. If you do have chimneys or bats going into chimneys, they're almost always on the outside face of the chimney, right where it enters the roof. There's often little cracks there. They'll crawl in there. They don't normally go into the main entrance at the top of a chimney. Just put on leather gardening gloves. Wait till they land, and then just you can normally, if you get them in that first grab, you can once you've tried once and missed, now they're on alert and they won't let you do that. Or just put a box over them, or just a big blanket and throw it over them. Any one of those things works. Right, right. I use leather gloves, but you know that's I'm also used to that. But yeah, no, the blanket actually works really well.
Give us your number, we'll call you.
No. I get enough calls about that already, and actually I've got to the point where I have a rule, and that is, are you looking at the bat right now? Because if you are, I'll come over and get it. But if you're not looking at it right now, I'm not going to come over in here and help you look because we'll spend hours and you'll never find it. They're such good hiders. Yeah.
Usually the first time you get a blanket, just take them outside. They'll fly in the daylight.
Oh yeah, you bet.
Go someplace.
Right. Okay, what else can I do for you? Anything else? Yes, very often. The thought is, though, that again, since they've made a mistake by coming in, bats will starve to death in about 48 hours. They'll die from evaporation, from dehydration in 36 hours. So they don't come into the house on purpose. That's almost 9 times out of 10, it's fatal for them. So they've made a mistake. Normally, they won't make the mistake twice. So the thought is, and this has actually been borne out a little bit by research, that people have abandoned the bats they've let go, and it's very rare for them to actually, you may get other bats come in, but it's pretty rare to get that same bat coming back in. Yeah, right.
If you get a cool spell, what temperature do they generally not fly?
That all depends on the insects, and again, it depends on if it's the time of year when females must feed, they'll feed. But at this time of year, if we get a night where, you know, you get temperatures where the nighttime low, by the time temperatures drop down to maybe 50, 53 degrees, the bugs just disappear, and they do too. It's actually one of the things that frustrates me about the school year at college, the way it's set up, is that I try and take students out to catch bats in the spring semester, but it's always so cold. So I've tried to convince Central to run the spring semester all the way to like mid-July so I can really have good success in catching bats, but they haven't fallen for that yet. But yeah, this time of year it's really tricky because as soon as that temp drops a little bit, boom, they just go sit somewhere and go to sleep. And in fact, they can essentially drop into hibernation every single night to save energy. So that's one of the cool things they can do too.
Do you catch birds in your
nest? Yes. Yeah, I'm not legally allowed to, and so I have to quickly get them out and let them go. But yeah, it's inevitable since you're setting up during the daytime hours, and then waiting for dark. Yeah, you inevitably catch some. The one that fits on their forearm, and it's just a plastic kind of a spring type of thing. It just fits on there and then snaps closed. But it's loose enough that you can actually slide it up and down. Because if it snaps too tight, then it'll actually cut off the circulation, then you create problems. So you make sure it slides freely. And then I'm going to guess we lose 50% of those over the course of several years. So it's not super effective. But to go to anything more permanent now risks being fatal for the bat. So I'm willing to take some losses. They occasionally will use the little pit tags that you can put in your dog, the little barcode, the magnetic chip reader. They've tried that with bats, but bats are so good at reaching back there, they'll actually pull them out of their own skin, and they end up finding them laying on the ground. Unfortunately, we were hoping that would really help us to identify bats in the long run, but it hasn't worked all that well.
Have you ever caught someone else's tag bat?
I have not, no. In fact, I've only, on a few instances, caught my own tag bats, which I think is also telling you how many bats there are around. If you go to the same spot year after year and ban bats year after year and only catch one or two back, then there's got to be a lot of bats in the area. Is that it?
Histoplasmosis
is a...
subjected to the blood you have to be before
you risk. That I don't know the answer to. I think in your setting, it's not an issue. Histoplasmosis is a fungus carried in mostly in poultry poop. So the poultry farmers have to definitely be aware of this. And normally it's big accumulations in a dry place, is my understanding. Because then as you're sweeping it up, all the stuff just powderizes and gets floating up in the air. And I think that's the issue you want to be worried about. I think in your case where you're just dealing with small amounts, don't let it accumulate. Go in there and scoop it out, every couple of weeks or so. I don't think it's going to be an issue for you. Especially since it's probably going to be at least humid, if not wet. So therefore, it's not going to dry and get into the air. So I don't think it's an issue for you.
Well, thank you.
Well, thank you very much.